Good morning to you.
Good morning.
No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here at South Church. And it is wonderful to be here with you in person today. And that doesn't mean that those of you who are online, that it isn't wonderful to be with you too. But you're just not as close as these folks here are. So nice to have you. Nice to have you with us. Some announcements.
Announcements. Oh, yes, you circled this on my announcements. I get to do the great announcement that daylight savings time is next Sunday. Union service at first. I'll be in Colorado visiting Trey, so my body will be all messed up, and so I guess daylight savings time will be irrelevant entirely in mountain time for me. But for you, you'll just be suffering for the next week. But you put that on your calendar. Also, the Board of Christian Outreach has asked me to draw your attention to the One Great Hour of Sharing envelopes in the pew or also online or text to give. It will help support the UCC's wider mission to help communities across the globe, including those suffering under the war in the Ukraine. And also, John Stevenson wanted to let you know that the Board of Christian Outreach has discussed finding the appropriate avenue to help people fleeing from the Ukraine and from other disasters. And they'll be doing a matching program. Look for further information on the email blast on Wednesday once they pick the charity and determine exactly how they are going to get the funds. All right?
Sarah.
I just want to bring your attention to youth group news, the middle school and high school combined youth group. It's the Sunday, March 13th, we'll be doing the youth building, not the 27th. I just have so many things, fun things scheduled for the youth group, and I was a little bit aggressive with my dates and got that one wrong. But it's not the 27th, it's going to be a faith journey, it's going to be the 13th. So please disregard that. That it's in the 27th year.
Thank you. We're aware that the mask protocols have been changed in the state of Connecticut. We're encouraging people to wear masks. If it's totally uncomfortable for you and it's not possible for you to do, we understand you can certainly take a mask off, except when we are singing. So everybody should have masks on when we sing. In today's service, we will be sharing communion together. We practice an open table, and so anyone who cares to share in that are invited to do so. And our opening hymn today is a relatively familiar one, On Eagle's Wings, but it is laid out rather confusingly on the page. So you might want to turn and note where the numbers of the verses are, which guide you through. The very confusing thing is that when you go to the top of the second page, that line is the very last line that we sing in the whole song. So, you're forewarned and you will still stumble. Sandy. Coffee and tea next door following the service. Thank you, Sandy. And now, as is our tradition, let's take a moment and pause, put our hands in our hearts, and take three deep breaths together. Thank you. Let us continue in preparation for worship.
Under God's wings, we will find refuge, for God is our life and our hope.
Thank you.
Good morning. Can I have all the children or people young at heart come on up, please? Our first Sunday of Lent. You can just take a seat around me. Good morning. All right, I'm going to start my message in about 20 or 30 seconds, okay? Okay, so we're just gonna wait. You can count, that's fine. All right, I'm ready to begin. You guys look a bit confused. Is there a problem? That was kind of boring, right? Let me ask everybody. We'll do a show of hands. Who thinks that waiting for 20 to 30 seconds before I start my message was not necessary? Raise your hand if you think it was not necessary. Kind of a lot of people raise their hand. I think, you know what, it probably is not necessary. Yeah. I don't think we needed to wait that long before I started, right?
What's the rush?
What's the rush? Don't throw me off here, I'm going somewhere. We didn't really need that time of stillness, right? We didn't need that time of quiet before my talk. But sometimes, waiting is necessary. Sometimes stillness is necessary. Sometimes quiet is necessary. Am I right, parents? Think of daffodils, right? Daffodils grow from bulbs. Did you know that? They don't grow from little seeds. They grow from bulbs. And they spend all winter underneath the ground, in the darkness, in the cold, frozen earth during winter. And just for a few short weeks, they bloom and you see their pretty flowers, right? Bright petals and the green leaves. For daffodils, a period of quiet and darkness and stillness is crucial. It's necessary for their growth. Did you know that Jesus spent some time wandering around in the desert?
Yeah.
Yeah? More than 20 or 30 seconds. He spent a lot of time out there. Not his whole life. He spent like 40 days and 40 nights. Wait, I know. Oh my God, right? How did, you know what? You can ask Denny those questions after. Okay. How he survived with no food. But it was way longer than 20 or 30 seconds, and he was alone, and things looked really bad for him for a while. He was waiting. It's easy to think of times like Jesus wandering in the desert, or this time of Lent, or a long, cold winter, as like something that has gone wrong, right? You guys probably thought when I was waiting it was something that had gone wrong. But let's think of our daffodils again. Winter is needed for them. Nothing is wrong. That time of waiting and stillness and quiet, that's just the way it's meant to be. You think the daffodils are bored? Probably. But you know what? They come out beautiful every year. So I think it is necessary. Let's do an echo prayer, shall we? You're going to repeat after me. That's an echo prayer. You're going to be like my echo. Okay? Mother God, thank you for the winter and the times of rest. Allow this time to nourish us so that we can rise again in beauty, like the daffodils. Amen.
Thank you.
Sunday as your deacon. Today's reading is Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. As we hear the words of Scripture, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days. And when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. The grass withers and the flower fades.
Easter, minus the Sundays. So the Sundays are in Lent, but not of Lent. I don't know who figured that out, but I guess that means you can have chocolate on Sundays. I have no idea. Oh, it's quite the text, right? These temptations of Jesus and I want to give a little different framework for it today. I want to frame it with a quote from theologian Howard Thurman, who spoke at Spelman College graduation a couple decades ago. He says this to the graduates, "There is something in every one of you that waits and listens for the sound of the genuine in yourself. There is something in every one of you that waits and listens for the sound of the genuine in yourself. It is the only true guide you will ever have. And if you cannot hear it, you will, all of your life, spend your days on the ends of strings that someone else pulls. If you cannot hear it, you will, all of your life, spend your days on the ends of strings that someone else pulls." In framing our story for today, this quote points us to see that temptations are something different than chocolate and eating meat, eating fish on Fridays. The temptation is to listen to the other voices. Our test is to see if we can hear and obey the sound of the genuine, the voice that speaks from the image of God deep inside of us. Luke is saying we can find the sound of the genuine by following Jesus' example here in the temptations. Go to the wilderness. Discover what distracts us from our mission. And trust that we belong to the ever-present God. Why go to the wilderness? Well, you know, the wilderness has a biblical meaning. The Israelites went to the wilderness for 40 years after they were released from enslavement in Egypt. And they were tested there. So Luke is kind of, you know, pull this story through that keyhole, and you get lots of associations. But why the wilderness at all? Well, because the normal externals of our life keep our sense of self in place. Our routine, our family, our friends, our job, all of them often just keep us humming along on the surface of life like everything is wonderful without going deeper to listen to the voices in which we are rooted. The wilderness is wild because we don't spend all of our time there. We don't really know our way around the wilderness with a loss of those familiar things that keep ourselves in place. And consequently, we are more likely to meet God and the devil in the wilderness because our routine protects us from this deeper presence. It wasn't in the text today, but the Spirit actually leads Jesus into the wilderness. The Spirit knows that the devil is there. But the Spirit and the devil are in cahoots with one another. They're part of the same force. Let me explain. I don't believe that the devil is a tiny person with a long tail and a pitchfork whose, you know, parts of his body is red. I don't think that has anything to do with reality. It's just an image people use for something. I think what is trying to be pointed out is that there is a voice inside of us that seeks first of all to protect our self, our individual self, above all else. And that voice has to be faced and dealt with. And the wilderness is a place where you can find that voice because our routine life often keeps us away from that. And exposing it in such a way enables us to hear the other voice, you know, to hear the image of God, the sound of the genuine within us. The devilish voice thinks it is protecting us from the dangers of our real calling in life. Jesus' calling was to proclaim that the kingdom of God is at hand. The society of love, peace, and justice, that the beloved community is at our fingertips. It's as close as the air that we breathe. It is not far away. It's right here. This is Jesus' proclamation. But this is what makes Jesus a threat to earthly kingdoms. And the devilish voice wants to distract Jesus from that dangerous path. What is at stake here is not whether or not Jesus does good or bad things, you know, eats chocolate or smokes cigarettes, but how he will accomplish his calling, his identity. his announcement of the kingdom of God, the society of compassion and justice, the beloved community. This is the sound of the genuine in Jesus. So the story takes him to the wilderness, right? 40 days he's there, and in 40 days he's weakened and he's disoriented. Why is he have to be disoriented? Because in order to discover the sound of the genuine in his own heart, he's not simply depending on externals to keep him in touch with his true identity. But believing in yourself is actually a difficult thing to do. So many things work on us to doubt ourselves. There are so many distractions from the sound of the genuine. My guess is you've got, family members, friends, co-workers who are very happy just to tell you how you should live your life. Mm-hmm. And you don't even have to ask them for advice. Believing in yourself is difficult. There are so many distractions from the genuine, like adoration and applause. The crowd trains you to do some things and not others because the adoration and the applause feels so good. And Jesus had a lot of that. Jesus also, by the way, had his family try to distract him from his mission. And then I find there's always some older, well-intentioned person who like the fellow in the movie The Graduate. Remember that one? I'm dating myself, I understand. There's this fellow who comes up to Dustin Hoffman's character, Ben Braddock, who is just a graduate himself from college, and he tells him the direction that he should go. And my guess is you can probably say it with me. The man says to him, "Plastics, my boy, plastics." Yeah. And later in Jesus' life, the Pharisees tell Jesus to stay away from Jerusalem because Herod wants to kill him. But that safety is a distraction from his own path. So he must be tested, as must we, so we don't simply depend on the response of others to shape our identity. And I've switched the saying around a little bit. The devil is in the distractions. The devil is in the distractions. Jesus could be distracted from his mission by serving himself. After 40 days without eating, I imagine Jesus is ravenous. I'm ravenous if I miss lunch. So, you know, in this vulnerability, he is tested. If you are the Son of God, and note the doubt that is implied with the word if you are the Son of God, then turn these stones into bread. And I know what the sensible response to this is. Whole grain toasted with blueberry jam on it. That's what ought to be done, because how can I help the world? How can I accomplish my mission if I'm starving? It's not going to work. It makes so much sense. Feed yourself. But Jesus is aware of something else. Jesus knows, that his identity is greater than his own personal hunger. And he says, quoting Deuteronomy, "One shall not live by bread alone." And everyone who first heard those words heard the implied words at the end of that verse, "But by every word that comes out of the mouth of God." Jesus is rooting his identity in God, greater than his personal hunger. In his weakened and powerless condition, he hears the devilish voice say that he could have all of the earthly authority and power of all the kingdoms of the world. All you have to do is worship me, the all-powerful self. And the sensible answer to that is, the response is, absolutely. Do you understand how much good I could do in the world if I had all earthly powers? Whoa! That's grand. That's the sensible answer to that. But Jesus is aware of something else. Jesus is aware that earthly power always comes with a cost. If you gain earthly power, it means you're in somebody's pocket. Every politician knows this. This is why it's so hard to trust politicians. In order to get to this place, you have to promise a whole bunch of people a lot of other things. Earthly power is not where Jesus' identity lay. It lay in the power of love, which is the power of God's love, and the authority of peace and justice. That's where Jesus' power lay. But the inner voice goes in to distract him with a quote from Scripture, because Jesus has been quoting Scripture. And the voice says, "Leap from the tip of the temple. Don't worry. God will save you. For it is written, the angels will bear you up and will not dash your foot against a stone." And while it seems to make sense, because there it is, it's right in Scripture, right? But it seems to make sense to go up this pinnacle and leap off and then wow everybody by being caught by angels, or not wow everybody by splatting on the sidewalk. Jesus sees the fallacy in this. That is, he is a humble human being. And humans are not to test God. It is God who tests humans, so to speak. So Jesus' identity in each of these tests is rooted in the ever-present God. Consequently, he passes the test for the time being. And the devilish voice, the distractions, retreat until a more opportune time. In other words, this voice is always with us. It's always right there, looking for a way to doubt our calling and our true identity, the sound of the genuine. We too are called by God. We will probably not enter the wilderness as Jesus did, but there will be wilderness times in our life when we are not certain where we are going. You've all had them, I'm sure. Times of struggles in a relationship, the death of a loved one, a divorce, the graduation, a change. I feel like I'm in a wilderness, you know, heading toward retirement. And people say, "What are you going to do in retirement?" And I say, "Shut up." Well, that's what I want to say. I don't usually say that. I make something up. But I feel like I should know. I mean, it's a wilderness. I don't know, you know? And, of course, here we are in this conversation with First Church, wondering what our future might be and what level of collaboration we might decide to join with them. And, of course, we're in the wilderness because of that as well. Of course, the pandemic puts us there too, and it's a very wilderness time, not only for us, but for the world. So, the question is, what is our calling in the midst of this? And our mission is the same of Jesus, as Jesus, to announce with our words and our actions the kingdom of God, the beloved community, to announce that it is at hand. We will be tempted to serve ourselves, thinking, we can serve others later. We will be tempted to grab for power, thinking we can accomplish our goals by lording our power over others. We will be tempted to test God and then blame God if things don't go our way. The question is, will we find our larger identity in God and God's ways, or through some form of self-centered, self-protective ways? My last piece here has to do with what's going on in the wilderness in the Ukraine. Rupert Spira is a spiritual teacher who online teaches people all over the world. He believes that all religions rest on the idea that reality consists in the interconnection of all things. You might guess that I would like that. I say that a lot to you folks. All things are interconnected. Well, a few days ago, March 1st, after the Russian invasion of Ukraine had begun, he delivered a message on Zoom. And people were able to ask questions afterward. And a fragile-looking young woman in her late 20s, named Aliana, was Zooming from Kyiv in the Ukraine. And she asked this question: how do I stay courageous in the face of death? The word courage comes from the word heart. How do I keep my heart, my identity, in the face of death? Rupert sat for a few moments without saying anything, and then his answer was this: Aliana, the source of all courage in the face of possible death is the recognition of the ever-present nature of being. Behind whatever fear may arise is the ever-present being, God's being, the only being there is. And the one that is ever-present is deathless. And real courage comes from that recognition. Real courage, I would say, comes from the sound of the genuine. I'm bringing those together. Rupert continues, many people in your country are now acting in a way that is consistent with this recognition without formulating it in this way. But that's all right. They are transcending themselves as a person. They are acting for something greater than themselves, something even greater than the Ukraine. They are acting for freedom. Their actions, their deep courage, whether they know it or not, comes from the deep recognition that what we are, essentially, transcends the limits of the individual person. And that recognition gives us the courage to transcend our individual personal needs and to act for a cause which is greater than our own personal survival. The people in your country may not use these words. The words are not important. The courage is. And Aliana thanked him, saying it was a very encouraging word. This is, I believe, what the Holy Spirit led Jesus to the wilderness for: to test his identity, to find the place of his courage. And he discovers it in the ever-present being, God's being, the only being there is. And our identity as well is not in our ability to serve ourselves, however we might try to turn stone into bread, nor is it in the power the world has to offer, even if someone could give it to us, nor in the ability to manipulate God to save us from every whatever height we might foolishly leap. The faith that Jesus has is courage. And that courage comes from listening to the sound of the genuine in yourself, which tells you that you are actually a part of God's being, like waves are part of the ocean. And as such, you transcend yourself. For that voice, that sound, the ocean itself, is the only true guide you will ever have. And if you cannot hear it, you will, all of your life, Spend your days on the ends of strings that someone else pulls. Amen.
Now is the time that we come together as a family of faith to share our joys and concerns. Our flowers this morning are from Roger and Diane Hertzdorf. Roger is still at Meadowbrook for a few weeks. He is accepting visitors, so I'm sure you'd be happy to see him. Of course, the people in the Ukraine are in your hearts this morning. What else? Sighs too deep for words. Come into prayer with me. Holy One, today is the first Sunday of Lent, a season of repentance, of self-examination, of silence and waiting for the leading of your Holy Spirit. Through your Spirit, you lead us into the temptations of Jesus. 40 days in the wilderness where our lives are laid bare and we come face to face with our desires for power. Power over our lives and the lives of our friends and our enemies and maybe even power over you. Open us to your grace and mercy, your love and provision as we confront our own temptations, the demons that try to distract us from our own calling. Give us the strength to throw off the insidious powers of sin, the forces of selfishness and pride, the forces that keep us from confronting the truth about our own lives and the world. During this season of Lent, shatter our illusions, save us from ourselves, and open us to the new life of your Holy Spirit, rooted in the power of God, a life of faith, hope, and love. As we let your Spirit lead us into repentance, may we discover the goodness and fullness of life in your kingdom of peace and justice. In the words of the psalmist, may we find in your presence a refuge, a dwelling place, a place of rest. And now, may we raise our voices together in the words that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We invite all people who feel that in their souls they need nourishment, they need hope. We invite all people of any stripe or nationality, any sexual orientation, any race, any nation. For this table is shared by people all over the world. And as we partake, we remember that though cathedrals are being bombed in the Ukraine, that the ever-present God is still there. And so we celebrate God's presence around the planet as we share in this meal together. Now, the words of institution. A week after Mary anointed Jesus' feet with perfume and washed them with her hair,
on the night when Jesus washed the feet of the disciples,
on the night of Passover, when Jesus was betrayed by Judas Iscariot,
on the night when Peter denied Jesus and the other disciples scattered for fear of their own lives, on the night before the religious and Roman powers nailed Jesus to a cross, when he would say, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
On that night at table, Jesus took a loaf of bread.
"You have taken me, O God, and chosen us to be bread for the world."
And when he had broken it and given thanks, he said, "This is my body broken for you."
Like Jesus who betrayed others, trust has been shattered, hearts have been broken, lives have been destroyed, we long to be made whole. Do this, Jesus said, in remembering me.
O God, as we eat this bread, might we be remembered,
transformed into the person and the community you intend us to be.
After supper, Jesus poured a cup of wine and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
So you have given us to the world, O God, that our lives might be poured out for the lost and the lonely, the last and the least. In this way, we participate in the fullness of life that Jesus promised. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim Jesus' death and the death of the innocent people of every time and place until that time when swords are turned into plowshares and all people live in peace.
Alleluia. Let us join the feast with joy
and thanksgiving
that we might be strengthened, heart and soul,
to prepare the world
and reveal the truth we have seen in Jesus.
To love God is to love neighbor and foreigner, stranger and foe, and this alone is the pathway to peace.
Well, in this odd COVID time, we have an odd way of taking communion together. You are to take the little plastic, thin plastic piece off the top, which exposes then the little square of bread there. And this represents the bread of life. And then that little silver underneath, which is sometimes hard to open up, and I'm always afraid I'm going to spill. Let's see, what did Sarah say? 20 seconds? Now, my friends, the cup of the new covenant, the hope of the beloved community, the society of justice and peace. Let us pray. We give thanks, O God, for the nourishment of this meal, for the nourishment of our community of faith, for the nourishment of music, for the nourishment of your presence, O God, which runs through all of these things and makes them possible. We give thanks for sisters and brothers around the world who are also nourished by the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And we give thanks for the reality of our interconnectedness and the ways in which our life is a part of all those. So be with us as we go from this place in joy and in gratitude. Amen. Please rise to sing.
Thank you.
say that in the first service, I participated in the prayer time. When I came off the sermon today, I was somewhere in La La Land and didn't get to the gratitude. But when we sing, stay with me. I'll be there. I'm coming. Many of you know that our son Aaron has been struggling with an addiction, with Adderall and alcohol. And so I lift up this gratitude. The faithfulness of God and God's community. I'm coming. My gratitude runs deep for many of you who have had him in prayer and us in prayer. And several of you have accompanied him to meetings. And I'm here to say that he's been living with us, painting our house, the inside walls, you know. Woo! It's beautiful. But it also means that there's a new him in the making, too. And so there's a new us as well. So, Norman, could you play Great Is Thy Faithfulness once more? I realize you took it, just the chorus of it. Because when we start singing that, it just all comes to me. How faithful.
Church of the weeping clergy, but also of the weeping congregants. There are 1,000 ways to live into our commitment to this community, as our benediction reminds us. If you're able to make a donation, there's a collection plate when you leave the sanctuary. If you're not able to, your presence here is truly a gift in and of itself. Thank you for being a part of us today. Please join me in the benediction. Go forth into the world and serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God. Rejoicing through the power of the Holy Spirit. The grace of Jesus Christ